for anesthetists also, this has a big relevance. Why? First, a position which might be comfortable for the surgeon for his approach might not be good physiologically for the patient itself. It may be resulting in physiological changes which may be detrimental for the patient. Secondly, as we move about in our daily lives and we have postural changes, like we sit down, we lie down, there are a lot of physiological influences taking place which keep our physiological variables within normal limits, like our heart rate, our blood pressure, our lung volumes. But once the patient is anesthetized, these compensatory responses are blunted and the patient is vulnerable to the change in these positions. Third, in today's day, peripheral nerve injuries are a very important cause of perioperative morbidity. And one of the major causes for this is faulty positioning, and we are supposed to take care of it. So what is our goal ideally as far as the position is concerned? Ideally, even under anesthesia, the patient should be in a position which he is able to tolerate when he's lying awake. And this is a team effort done simultaneously with the involvement of the anesthesiologist, the surgeons, and our staff. So we have a quick review about the physiology, that what is changing when with the change of posture. When we are standing erect, the blood is majorly cooling down in the capacitance veins in the lower limb. And as we put lie down the patient on the table, this gets evenly distributed, resulting in an increase in venous return, thereby an increase in the stroke volume, increase in the cardiac output, and increase in the blood pressure. But this increase in blood pressure is instantly taken care of by the activation of various baroreceptors and stretch receptors, which decrease the heart rate and decrease the cardiac contractility, thereby bringing the blood pressure back within the normal limits. Now, once we anesthetize this patient, these responses are going to be blunted, and any change in position from now on is going to affect these variables. As you can see here, this is what the respiratory changes take place. Now, this solid line here, you can see, this is the initial position of the diaphragm when a person is standing erect. As soon as you lie supine, this shifts cephalid, and this is the resting position again. And this moves further cephalid with the induction of anesthesia, then when we give muscle paralysis by neuromuscular blockers, and then finally after surgical positioning and displacement. So the movement has been from here to here. So the FRC is reduced in approximately by 800 ml immediately when we lie down, and further because of these effects, a further 25-30% decrease, leading to basal eclectasis. And in this position, the patient is lying down, this is the dependent portion of the lung which will be getting the most perfusion. But here the ventilation is reduced, resulting in a VQ mismatch. As I've told earlier, this is see what is happening when the patient is lying down and anesthesia has been induced. The basal alveoli have collapsed, the diaphragm has shifted further up, and as in erect posture, this is the zone getting the most perfusion, which is here in this case. So there is a VQ mismatch. Now what happens when we turn this patient prone? In the cardiovascular system, bears the most important brunt because there is an immediate decrease in cardiac output of approximately 25-30%. Now what is the major cause of this? The major cause is the decrease in venous return. And there are two major factors for this. One is because of the IVC obstruction because of abdominal compression. And secondly, because of the decreased thoracic compliance, there is an increase in thoracic pressure, so the filling of the heart is affected. Since there is a decreased venous return, obviously the stroke volume and cardiac output, everything gets decreased. Then what happens to the respiration or the ventilation? This is actually one position which has a beneficial effect on ventilation, and that is why it is used in many critical care units in ARDS patients, the prone ventilation as we call it. As you can see in the supine position, this is the basal part of the lung which is getting the most perfusion, but because of the effect, gravitational effect of the heart, these alveoli are collapsed. So again, this is the region of VQ mismatch. So the FRC is decreased. Also because of the weight of the abdominal contents shifting towards the diaphragm, it is shifted cephalid, and its excursion during inspiration and expiration is limited, so which results in a decrease in tidal volume. Now what happens when we turn this patient prone? The gravity pulls the heart away from these basal alveoli, so they reopen and the diaphragmatic excursion is also increased. So prone position actually increases the FRC and the tidal volume as compared to supine position, which is the major benefit for this position. But this can be achieved only if the abdomen is free to move. If there is any external compression of the abdominal wall, there will be increased intra-abdominal pressure, which is going to shift this shift the abdominal contents against the diaphragm and further up, leading to a total loss of this advantage, which we could have if the abdomen had been free. And in an anesthetized patient, sometimes with the rising trends of obesity today, it is very difficult to achieve. Now, what are the disadvantages of prone position? Now, there's a major list of it. The advantage mainly is the pulmonary part, which I've just said. And this list is the basic reason why we are preferring supine PCNLs here at our center as compared to prone PCNL. So first of all, as I've already told, there's a decrease in cardiac output immediately when you turn the patient prone. Now, this has one or two more implications in the sense that if any untoward anesthetic complication or surgical complication were to happen in the prone position, we don't have much access to the patient for insertion of lines or any invasive monitoring. And plus, if CPR is required, our traditional training is to turn the patient supine and then start it, which can lead to loss of valuable time. Then regarding the airway in this in this position is very fragile in the sense we are using a flexometallic tube for patients in prone position, which is easy, very prone to dislodgement, and also endobronchially it can get pushed down. Then they have, these are wire reinforced tubes, they have small wires in the walls. If the patient during, usually we put in a bite block, but sometimes if the block gets displaced or the patient bites on that tube, those wires will be compressed and they are not going to spring back to the original position. So we have an obstructed airway in the prone position, which is a nightmare for any anesthetist. Then increased neck flexion can lead to endobronchial displacement. Further, a greater depth of anesthesia is needed for maintenance in a prone position as compared to a supine position. Then all sorts of peripheral nervous system injuries, with injuries to the radial nerve, ulnar nerve, brachial plexus, lateral peroneus nerve, thigh, and all these injuries have been documented. And patients who are coming with certain comorbid conditions like diabetes or who already have a peripheral vascular disease are more prone to getting these injuries in the prone position. Then ocular damage, visual loss because of decreased perfusion pressure is a known complication of the prone position. The neck injury because of excessive torsion or hyperflexion can cause cervical nerve root or vascular compression. Then any skeletal injury which the patient may be having may be further exacerbated by this position. Direct pressure injuries, like here to the eye, ears, cheeks, and all the pressure points can occur in spite of proper padding. Then we come to the ergonomics of it, that putting the patient in the prone position does require extra equipment. The specialized padding is needed, reinforced endotracheal tubes, extra monitoring for patients in prone position, especially who are coming with comorbid conditions, because immediately when you turn the patient prone, that is the most vulnerable time when the BP can go down, and prone position per se is going to cause a decrease in the cardiac output. Then also it increases the OR time, so the number of surgeries which can be done in an allotted time frame are less, and extra staffing costs because a minimum of 5 people are needed to turn the patient prone safely and then again turn him back supine when the patient has to be extubated. So now we come to the next important question, whether to give general anesthesia to these patients or regional anesthesia. General anesthesia, with its positive pressure ventilation and addition of positive end expiratory pressure, can increase the mean intrathoracic pressure, which can again lead to a decrease in cardiac output. But GA has certain advantages. Like if the surgeon does decide to go for a surgery in a prone position, he's comfortable that way, then we have a secured airway in prone position. So if any untoward incidents happens, then we at least have one thing in hand. then the feasibility to control tidal volume. If suppose there the surgeon has to take a higher approach for a stone high up in the kidney and he has to make a higher puncture, then there is a risk of pleural injury. In such cases, if the patient is under general anesthesia on controlled ventilation, we can simply disconnect the ventilator at the end of expiration. So the pleura would be high up, making it less prone to puncture. And as in case of a technically difficult case or a large stone load, yes, prolonging the duration of the anesthesia is easier. Now, what are the advantages of regional anesthesia as compared to general anesthesia? The list is quite longer. As we can see, there is less post-operative pain, less blood loss because the mean arterial pressure is less with regional anesthesia and early recovery. Decreased incidence of post-operative nausea and vomiting because patient exposure to multiple anesthetic drugs is not there. It is very well tolerated, especially in elderly and patients with having comorbidities like obesity, neurological diseases, and pulmonary disease. And the best thing is that patients can position themselves according to their comfort. So the chance of pressure injuries and nerve injuries in at least the unanesthetized part is much less. Then detection of any electrolyte imbalance and features of overload will be detected earlier because the patient can tell you that he is feeling irritable or he is dizzy or he is uncomfortable. Whereas under GA, these would be manifested only when they reach the point of a hemodynamic instability. But regional anesthesia has its disadvantages as well. For example, there is a risk of sudden hypotension after making the patient prone. One, because of the prone position itself is decreasing the cardiac output. And secondly, because if you are giving regional anesthesia, there is pooling of blood in the lower extremity. So both these factors can compound the hypotension. Then patient discomfort increases if the procedure goes beyond a certain limit. And as I said earlier, the advantage of GA is the disadvantage here, that if the surgeon has to make a puncture higher, then patient has to coordinate his breathing, which might not be possible for each and every patient. And this is the plan-free obliquifying modified lithotomy position, which sir has just discussed, which we are using here. Now, from the anesthetic point of view, this is basically a combination of lithotomy and lateral decubitus position, because our shoulders are absolutely 90 degrees to the table. And this lithotomy is also a modified lithotomy because this leg is almost in lithotomy position, but this is going down the table. So this is not a proper lithotomy position. So what happens? This is a classical lithotomy position. What happens here? As because the legs are getting raised up, there's increase in venous return to the heart, so the cardiac output and the blood pressure are increased. Secondly, this position pushes the intra-abdominal contents towards the diaphragm. So again, the lung compliance and the lung volumes will be decreased. Another problem with this position is the lower extremity compartment syndrome. Why does this occur? Every 2.5 centimeter increase in height above the heart decreases the mean arterial pressure by 2 millimeters of mercury. So the arterial supply here can be hampered depending on you're taking a high lithotomy or a low lithotomy. And also on the duration of surgery. Mostly to see on surgeries who are extending more than 2 to 3 hours. But here, in this position which we are using, these effects are negated to some extent because, as I said earlier, that it is not a proper lithotomy. Only one leg is raised above the level while the other, the ipsilateral one, is going down the table. And there is a loss of the normal lordotic curvature of the lumbar spine, aggravating to previous low back pain. So this was the question you were asking. So lower back pain can be exacerbated, but if we are giving regional anesthesia to the patient, sometimes it becomes difficult because majority of the people have this concept that since I have been given spinal, my back is going to ache. So sometimes it's very difficult to say whether it was because of the positioning or it's just patient's mental makeup. Then peripheral nerve injuries in this positioning, the saphenous nerve can get pressed against the medial malleolus, the common peroneal nerve against the head of the fibula. So these two parts have to be adequately padded with no undue pressures over it. As far as the femoral nerve and the obturator nerve are concerned, the classic lithotomy, we flex the legs to between 80 to 100 degrees. If we are flexing the thigh to more than 90 degrees, then there's a chance of stretching of the inguinal ligament and chances of injury to both these nerves is increased. then what happens to the ventilation in the lateral position? As far as the cardiac output is concerned, cardiac out in the when the patient is turned lateral, there is not much increase or decrease in the cardiac output. It remains the same. But the ventilation has a big bearing, and a very big bearing on whether in the position which we are using here, whether we want to go for a GA or a regional anesthesia. As you can see here, in the dependent lung, because of the gravity, the perfusion will be more, whether we give patients general anesthesia or a regional anesthesia. But what about the ventilation? The ventilation in an awake patient, that is a patient who has been given regional anesthesia, would be more in the dependent lung, and anesthetized patient in the non-dependent lung. You can compare it to like when you start inflating a balloon. When you start initially inflating it, the resistance is more because you're starting from zero volume. So it is this part of the curve. It's basically a compliance curve for the lung. It is this part that a great deal in change in pressure will produce only a small change in the volume. While when it has inflated to a certain degree, you blow it up further, it is easier. This is this part of the curve. And when again it's nearing its total capacity, again, the change in volume for change in pressure is very less because again it becomes difficult and more pressure is required. Similarly, in the lungs, in an awake patient who's spontaneously breathing, the dependent lung is on this part of the curve, easy to inflate, and this is the one getting the most perfusion as well. So VQ ratio is good. While if the patient is in general anesthesia, then because of the weight of the mediastinal structures, the lung volume is compressed. So the dependent lung moves from this portion of the curve to this portion of the curve, difficult to inflate. And the non-dependent lung moves to the more compliant portion. So the ventilation is preferentially distributed here and perfusion is preferentially distributed here, resulting in more VQ mismatch than you would have in a spontaneous VQ patient. And again, injury to the dependent parts here again, dependent eye and ear can be there. And compression of dependent axillary structures, for which we put an axillary roll. Now, axillary roll is actually a misnomer because we never put it in axilla. We put it caudal to the axilla to prevent compression of the neurovascular bundle, which is there in the axilla. So, to summarize the pros and cons of these four positions, the cardiac output and venous return, as I've said, are much more decreased in the prone position as compared to the modified supine which we are using. Then FRC, again, if we can keep the abdomen free, yes, in prone position it's better. And as far as the it will be better in the regional anesthesia in supine, modified supine, for the reasons I've just explained, as compared to the general anesthesia. Same goes for the VQ matching. Then airway is definitely at increased risk in a prone patient who's anesthetized. And risk for pleural injury again is more in a patient who's spontaneously breathing rather than a patient who is on positive pressure ventilation. Patient positioning, obviously it is most difficult to put a anesthetized patient in a prone position, and it's easiest with a patient who's awake and in the supine position because the upper body part he can position himself and actually tell you which position or which arm position is most comfortable for him. Depth of anesthesia, in prone position, we require more. Risk of ocular damage, peripheral nervous system injuries, direct pressure injuries is much more in a prone position under GA. Post-operative nausea vomiting for obvious reasons is more in patients who are generally working in general anesthesia. And blood loss is also less for patients who have been given regional anesthesia because of decrease in the mean arterial pressure. And post-op pain again is less with regional anesthesia. Then some in special scenarios like elderly, obesity, patients having respiratory disease and motor neuron disease. Regional anesthesia in supine position is much more preferable because of the above mentioned advantages. And as far as the cost implication goes, these are least in the supine position in regional anesthesia and most in the if you're using prone position and giving general anesthesia.
Not a question, actually a small comment. Most of the time we really rarely talk to our anesthetists. We only talk when they are not giving us the case. if they give the case easily, so nobody wants to talk anyway. So, but it's so important. For me also, I've learned so many things, which most of the time we neglect. Like the particular part, I talk many colleagues and urologists, they say we commonly do prone PCNL under spinal anesthesia. But I would say we have really been ignorant on the cost of the patient, because we clearly know that the ventilation part, which patient is managing on own while under spinal anesthesia, especially more problematic if patient is obese or with some comorbidity. So that is something really should be, I guess, discouraged to really do so. If some problem has not happened so far, it doesn't mean it can't happen. One has to really match the numbers to beat the stats. So that's my point. Anyone want to ask anything?
What are the cases you would like to give general anesthesia for these patients?
So in supine position?
Yeah.
In a spinal, for a spinal.
So anywhere, if the surgeon is expecting a prolonged duration of surgery, or sometimes we are giving cases with patients with a borderline hemoglobin and bleeding is expected, then maybe. Or in some cases, like patients are coming with a progressive neurological disorder. In that case, we cannot give regional anesthesia. It's a pure contraindication. So we have to give general anesthesia to those patients. And sometimes it's the patient's choice also, that they don't want to be awake during the surgery. They want, they say, we don't want to be awake.
The thing is, your take on patients, whenever you want to have a supercostal approach, sometimes...
Yes, it may be beneficial, yes. That will be, I'm saying, that will be the surgeon's decision. If they say that, you know, the chances of pleural injury are more, or have to go for a higher puncture, then definitely, because the control of ventilation is more in our hands under GA rather than regional.
But isn't regional level is generally, they say T5. So even if we go 10th rib or 11th rib, isn't that part quite taken care of?
No, sir, that is just taking part of the pain thing.
Pain.
Ventilation.
Yes. But if you're puncturing the pleura, you have to ask the patient to hold this breath at the end of expiration, which is most patients don't understand.
Tricky, yeah.
They'll take in a deep breath and then hold the patient, so your pleura is maximally down.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.